Hello and welcome back to the Black Ponder. I'm Neil Trotter and we're back here outside in the park. Yeah, it's gonna be my the shadow is gonna be cast on my face. Sorry. I don't wanna sit in the sun because then I'll get too hot and start sweating. And yeah, you know, y'all don't care, right? It's just a little shade, no big deal, right? Enjoy the ambiance. Today what we're going to talk about actually is an essay. We're going to return back to some Emma Goldman, political philosopher, and we're going to be talking about her essay, Minorities versus Majorities. Now in this essay, Minorities versus Majorities, she argues that the current democratic system that we have, where you know you have a vote in this majority rule, that is inadequate for human progress, right? There's a better way. Now, the majority rule way is not the best way to go about doing things, about deciding important issues that affect society and human endeavors, right? Is this an accurate critique? Is this something that we can actually talk about in a philosophical, logical way? I believe so. I believe Emma Goldman brought up some good points. When I first read the title of Minorities versus Majorities, the first thing I thought about, the very first thing, was this article I read way back in the day in this music magazine called Under the Radar. It was an interview with this Canadian pop indie duo, although I don't think they're indie anymore, Tegan and Sarah. I love Tegan and Sarah, their music. Their recent music anyway, their album that they came out last year, Love You to Death, I think it's called, is my favorite album of the year. I'm actually way more into music than I am into philosophy, but that's beside the point. Let me show you a picture from that article. Here's a little picture. Here they are up. Can you see? I think you can see it. They're holding a sign. This is Tegan and Sarah, the indie pop group, and it says the rights of the minority should never be subject to the whim of the majority. So this indie pop duo, Tegan and Sarah, they're twins, they're identical twins, and they're both gay. They just happen to be gay, and so their music has always had some sort of social commentary on gay rights. But their latest album, really like out in the open, it was about love and particularly gay love. Now this article was written, it was an interview from one of the members, Tegan, and this article was written in 2012. I still remember it to this day, and she talked about, and this was when gay marriage was still unlawful, and California had a vote, like a proposition. The vote turned out, upheld the unlawfulness of gay marriage. Now actually to today, gay marriage is legal in America due to the Supreme Court decision. However, that may change depending on how aggressive this current presidential administration is. You know, that might change, who knows. But the idea is that, you know, there are more heterosexuals out there than there are homosexuals. Homosexuals are the minority. So it's likely if you leave it up to a vote, majority rule, that issues like gay marriage will never be truly upheld in law, because most people aren't really concerned with that, because most people aren't homosexual. I would like to read you a little segment of that article. The interviewer asked Tegan, one of the sisters, "To be honest, I don't think any remotely mainstream politician cares if gay people marry. In their heart of hearts, no Republican to the left of Rick Santorum cares." And then Tegan responds, "I absolutely believe that the average person out there doesn't care, including gay people." I mean, when all the gay marriage heat came up in 2008, I think it was Rufus Wainwright who said, "Why do we want to get married?" I guess Rufus Wainwright is a popular gay figure. "I don't want to get married. Why do I want to be like everybody else? I didn't think about it either, but then when someone wants to take away your rights, then it's like, hold on a second. If I agree with you, I know lots of Republicans. I have Republicans in my family, and they don't care. They're like, this whole thing of marriage. People get married and divorced 10 times in their life, and then those people turn around and say, well, we've got to protect marriage. So the issue presented is, like, just because most people don't care, is it right for those that do care to not be able to be allowed to do something because the majority doesn't care? Like she even said, even a lot of gay people don't care about getting married. But for the gay people that do care about getting married, should they be subject to that lack of concern or that majority opposition even? Is it moral? Like, is it ethical that because most people are not in favor or aren't concerned with what they want to do, because of that, these people aren't allowed to take advantage of the same opportunities and rights that the majority does? Is it moral that the minority is subject to the whim of the majority? Is that ethical? Is that even philosophically logical or rational? This is what we're going to talk about here. We turn now to Emma Goldman's essay. Let me read you this quote. In the struggle for supremacy, the various political parties outdo each other in trickery, deceit, cunning, and shady machinations, confident that the one who succeeds is sure to be hailed by the majority as a victor. That is the only God, success. As to what expense, what terrible cost to character, is of no moment. We have not far to go in search of proof to verify this sad fact. We don't have to go far at all. We don't have to go that far in the past even. I mean, that's just happened recently in our political climate. To win over the majority rule, it's not about truth, right? You know, a lot of trickery, a lot of cunning, a lot of shady business is done. I mean, that's even considered normal. Like people say, well, that's politics. Politics is shady, it's trickery, it's deceit. It's a lot of people talking really horrible things about each other. That's politics, right? So is gaining the majority rule, is that even concerned with doing what's best for human progress? Or is it just about succeeding politically? Emma Goldman brings this up, in fact. Let's bring up the next quote. The oft-repeated slogan of our time is, among all politicians, the socialists included, that ours is an era of individualism of the minority. Only those who do not probe beneath the surface might be led to entertain this view. Have not the few accumulated the wealth of the world? Are they not the masters, the absolute kings of the situation? Their success, however, is due not to individualism, but to inertia, the cravenness, the utter submission of the mass. The latter wants but to be dominated, to be led, to be coerced. Here Emma Goldman is talking about how, in reality, the majority don't really rule at all, right? She's saying that, you know, the people who actually rule in our current governmental system is the minority, the rich elite, right? And that's not a new concept. We're going through this right now with the whole 99% versus the 1%, the elite. The socioeconomically privileged versus the middle class, which is dwindling, right? The middle class is shortening, and more people are going toward the socioeconomic lower class, and fewer people are going to the higher socioeconomic class. And we are starting to no longer have this middle class, right? And so the minority is getting all the power while the majority is suffering all the consequences and being dictated by this elite minority class. I mean, even Emma Goldman is bringing this point up. Like, we like to think that majority does rule, but when you look at it social economically, that's not really the case, is it? Let's continue with this other quote. Publishers, theatrical managers, and critics ask not for the quality inherent in creative art, but will it meet with a good sale? Will it suit the palate of the people? Alas, the palate is like a dumping ground. It relishes anything that needs no mental mastication. As a result, the mediocre, the ordinary, the commonplace represents the chief literary output. It is said that the artists of today cannot create, because Prometheus, like, he is bound to the rock of economic necessity. Basically, Emma Goldman's talking about how we have to dumb down because we're forced to appeal to the masses, the majority. We have to handicap art or individualism or artistic expression that needs to be universalized, generalized to meet as many people as possible, right? And that's not conducive to progress. And as our social economic climate is becoming more and more difficult, as the middle class is shortening, right, and the elite class is getting more power but becoming smaller and smaller, this is becoming even more true, where human progress, human expression, truth itself is handicapped, is universalized, is generalized, is getting dumbed down, is preventing people from progressing society, from making society better. Here's another quote, very interesting. The most unpardonable sin in society is independence of thought. That this should be so terribly apparent in a country whose symbol is democracy is very significant of the tremendous power of the majority. Independent thought doesn't appeal to the majority, therefore it's hard to be successful. When you focus on a minority group, then you're kind of sidelined. Kind of like the example of gay marriage. That's very important for a minority group, but the majority doesn't take issue with that, either doesn't care or is opposed to that. Humanity can't progress. Let's continue with that thought of independent thought being the ultimate atrocity in a democratic society. Every effort for progress, for enlightenment, for science, for religious, political, and economic liberty emanates from the minority and not from the mass. Today, as ever, the few are misunderstood, hounded, imprisoned, tortured, and killed. The principle of brotherhood expounded by the agitator of Nazareth preserved the germ of life, of truth, and justice. And she's talking about Jesus. So long as it was the beacon light of the few. The moment the majority seized upon it, that great principle became a shibboleth and harbinger of blood and fire, spreading, suffering, and disaster. The attack on the omnipotence of Rome, led by colossal figures like Huss, Calvin, and Luther, was like a sunrise amid the darkness of the night. But as soon as Luther and Calvin turned politicians and began catering to the small potentates, the nobility, and the mob spirit, they jeopardized the great possibilities of the Reformation. They won success in the majority, but the majority proved no less cruel and bloodthirsty in the prosecution of thought and reason than was the Catholic monster. Woe to the heretics, to the minority, who would not bow to its dicta. And Emma Goldman here is referring to the institution of religion. It's interesting, a lot of philosophers that are against religion, they're not so much against religious practice or God or religious figures. They're more so, lots of philosophers are heavily critique the institution of religion, the commodification of religion, forcing religion to accommodate to the whims of the majority, to win over the popular society, to become more powerful through popularity, through as many people as possible accepting their institution. Religion gets dumbed down. Possibility of religion, the ability for religion to progress human society forward, is hindered. All right, this is the argument that Emma Goldman talks about, and this is actually an argument that a lot of philosophers talk about. There are many philosophers who are against religion, but a lot of those philosophers who are against religion are not against spiritual practice. More so, they're against the institutionalization of that spiritual practice. And it boils down to this idea that institutionalization is appealing to the masses, to gain success, economic success, and that is a trade-off. You're dumbing down human progress for economic benefit. They don't necessarily correlate with each other. It's something to consider. The living, vital truth of social and economic well-being will become a reality only through the zeal, courage, and non-compromising determination of intelligent minorities, and not through the mass. But is this really true? One could read this essay and be left with, well, okay, so what's your alternative? You're saying that majority rule is not the best way to decide upon issues of society, but okay, so then what do we do? I mean, it's the best system we have thus far. That's what a lot of people say. Democracy isn't perfect, government isn't perfect, but it's the best thing that we have so far. And there's no such thing as really a truly perfect system. You might be left with that. Now, and this essay doesn't go in particular into detail about the alternatives, right? It just is a critique about why the focusing only on the majority rule is not necessarily good for human progress. But Emma Goldman does bring up some alternatives, and I've made a video about her, probably her most famous essay, on anarchism, what does it really mean, where she goes more in depth about the alternatives, and she talks about how there is no cookie cutter one system fits all, because people are different and societies are different. Like, for example, when we talked about the homosexual and heterosexual marriage, like, these are different needs, right? And we need different types of societies and different forms of government, or no government at all, right? Just different ways of leadership to accommodate either group. And she also delves more into that in her other essays, which we will continue to talk about as we continue to make videos about Emma Goldman. But tell me what you think. Let me know what's up in the comments section. What do you think about majority rule? Do you think it's actually the best way of going about things? I mean, I know plenty of people, right, that say, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, the majority decides what we need to do. And if things didn't go the way you won, if you're the minority, you just gotta sit down and take it. You know, I mean, this is a system that we have and we gotta accept it. I know plenty of people who are like that. And then there are other people who are not like that. How do you feel about it? Feel free to comment below. And I will continue to sit here in the shade as the shadow of the trees makes the black ponder more black than he really is. Maybe I could do something to the editing software to make myself a little bit brighter. I don't know. We'll see. It doesn't really matter. It's about the content of the text. It's not about my appearance per se. Anyway, this is a Black Ponder. Tune in next time for more philosophical thought.